In this session, we'll be covering the last half of chapter 2, chapter 2, verse 12 to the end of the chapter. But let me remind you again to take notes. You write down definitions of terms or words or different translation that I might give. Keep your Bible open and follow word for word. You'll get far more from it if you will do so. Now, before we begin, I'd like to give a quick review of what we've already covered. Paul is addressing the epistle to the Philippians to thank them for that gift which they had sent unto him by one of their members by the name of Epaphroditus, and also to encourage them to be faithful in their witness for Christ. In chapter 1, after addressing himself to each believer in the assembly rather than to the church, because each person there had participated in the gift, he says, "I thank my God upon the basis of my total remembrance of all of you people back there in Philippi, and I make supplications over you upon the basis of your joint participation in the gospel from the first day that Lydia was saved until the present time. And I'm convinced this very thing, that God who has begun this good work in you of being joint participants in the gospel will consummate it during the day of Jesus Christ. And I have much confidence in you, and I'm convinced also that you'll be faithful in this because you defend the gospel verbally and you can confirm it by the way you live. And I know you have a great love for the souls of men and for Christ and the cause of Christ. And I pray that that love you have will abound more and more in full knowledge and in a discernment in order that you can discern things that go in different directions and that you might be filled with the fruits of righteousness as you enter into the day of Christ. Now, I know that you think my imprisonment has hindered the cause of Christ, but contrariwise, it has been a means of taking the gospel in the areas it could have not have gone had it not been for my imprisonment. So I want you to continue to be faithful witnesses back there in Philippi, but not in the same way that you've always done it. Now I want you to go forth as if you were only one soul striving together with the faith of the gospel and recognizing that it was granted you as a privilege in the behalf of Christ, not only to believe into him, but also to suffer for his sake. And as you go forth witnessing, don't do anything for vain glory or empty self-exaltation, but all of you be of the like mind, having a mind of humility in which you're concerned for others more than you are for yourself, having the same mind, thinking, or attitude in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Now, Christ had this kind of a mind, and the whole Godhead highly exalted him and blessed him with a name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, and they'll do it to the glory of God the Father. Now, verse 12, Paul goes on to say, "Wherefore, my beloved, my highly valued ones, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence." Now, that's a great thing to have been said, that the believers at the church in Philippi had always obeyed whatever he had taught. That would be a great congregation to be a pastor over, that they would always do and obeyed what he had said. So he says, "As you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, it's important that you obey what I'm telling you, that you have the same mind, thinking, and attitude in you, which was also in Christ Jesus." Now, it's an interesting thing that this kind of a thing is never said to any other epistle or any other church throughout all of the New Testament, because the church at Philippi was the most spiritual church in the Bible. He could admonish them then to go on to the very height of spiritual Christian living. Remember what Christ taught. If you have fruit trees that are bearing fruit, you don't leave them alone. You purge them, you prune them, that they might bring forth more fruit. If it's not bringing forth any fruit, you cut it down and burn it and put something else in its place. Now, here, these Philippian believers were bearing more fruit and being more effective and faithful than any other church, so they're the only ones that he could go far enough to say, now you go on to the final step of spiritual maturity, of having the same mind, thinking, and attitude in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. So now it's much more important in my absence that you do this. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Now notice what he did not say and what he did say. He did not say work in order to obtain salvation. He did not say to work in order to retain salvation. He said work in order to work out that salvation which you already have. It's yours. Work out your own salvation. You already have it. Now work it out. Now what do you mean by work out your salvation? Well, the word carries a concept like this. Suppose the youngsters in school get an assignment to work out 20 math problems. What do they do when they work out those math problems? They carry them to their ultimate conclusion. So he's saying, you carry to its ultimate conclusion the salvation which is already yours, that which you have. Now, what is the ultimate conclusion of our salvation? Of course, it is Christ-likeness. And if we are Christ-like and like Him, then we will have the same mind, thinking, and attitude in us, which was also in Christ Jesus. And he says to do it with fear and trembling. Now, that would be better rendered anxiety and self-distrust. Do it very anxiously and eagerly and with no trust and no confidence in yourself. Now, the reason we are not to have any confidence in ourselves to do it, that we cannot have that, is because it is God who worketh in you both to will and to do of His good pleasure. Now, bringing this to its ultimate conclusion, this is a type of a thing of having the mind, thinking, and attitude in you which was in Christ Jesus is not something we have by a decision that we make. You can make the decision to receive Christ and do so. After you're saved, you can make that decision to follow Him in believer's baptism and be obedient and do so. You can make that decision you're going to tithe and give, or you're going to be a witness and just willfully begin to do so. But you cannot make the decision, I'm going to have the mind and attitude in me that was in Christ Jesus, and have it. It is something that has to be energized and worked out, and before we finish this epistle, we will see exactly how that can be accomplished in one's life. So he says, work it out with anxiety and self-distrust, no confidence in yourself. Why? For or because it is God. It is the God, the Godhead, who is working in you, who worketh in you. This word worketh is the Greek word energon, a form of the word energē, from which we get our word energy. So he's saying it is God who is energizing in you both. And he names two things. The word both refers to two things, both this and that. It is God who energizes in us as believers, first of all, to will and to do. Now, to will is one word in the Greek, and it's preceded by the definite article the. The word will would be better rendered desire. It is God who energizes in us, first of all, the desire, and secondly, to do. To do is also one word in the Greek text, and it is also preceded by the definite article the, and it's also a form of that word energē. It's the word energēn. So he says, it is God who energizes in you both the desire and the energy to work effectively of the good pleasure. Now notice the word His is in italics, although the concept is there. The good pleasure, which is His good pleasure, the pleasure of God. Now, what is the good pleasure of God concerning all believers? That we all have the same mind, thinking, and attitude in us, which was also in Christ Jesus. So it is God who energizes in you the desire as well as the energy to work effectively of the good pleasure of God. And further in the epistle, we're going to see exactly how that can be energized and what caused it to be so. First of all, you must make that decision, I am going to be an active witness for Christ. And you come to the point that you can defend the gospel verbally and you confirm it with the way you live. When you begin to live on that spiritual plane, then eventually God will energize in you this desire as well as the effective working it out in your life. Then he goes on to say, do all things without murmurings and disputings. Now this word do is a present active imperative. He says, do it this way, always do it this way. It's your active responsibility to do so, not that the Spirit of God makes you do it. But you, by the enactment of your own will do these things, and it's imperative that you do so if you want to be in the will of God and be right with God. So do all things without murmurings and disputings. Now the word murmurings is what we call an onomatopoeic word. In other words, the pronunciation is the definition. Murmuring. Now, you know, sometimes after a church service, some people will gather together in the corner over here somewhere out in the huddle in the yard and they mumble and complain about things. That's what he's talking about. As you go about in your service for Christ and being a witness for Christ, all that you do, do it without murmurings and without disputings. Now, why? Because if we have open disputes about matters, it's going to get out into the community and it will destroy the whole witness of the church and the cause of Christ, and people will not put their confidence in your witness. Now, here's the reason that you do it without murmurings and disputings. That you may be blameless and harmless. That you may be blameless. You can't be blamed for anything. And that you are harmless. Or that word harmless means unmixed or unadulterated. It is a word that is used in the secular writings of the same day of the writing of the New Testament. Of pure metal without alloy. There's no alloy there. It's all pure. So he's saying that you're unadulterated in any way, that you're pure in your life. So you're blameless and you're harmless, you're unadulterated, the sons of the children of God without rebuke are unblameable. You cannot be blamed with anything now if you are doing your witnessing without murmurings and disputings. Then he says, you will be blameless in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation or generation. Now every generation of humanity is crooked and perverse. That is the nature of man from our old sinful Adamic nature which we have. So he says, you can be without these things, without this rebuke in the midst of this perverse generation among which you are living, if you do these things without murmurings and disputings, as he said up above. Now, among whom, that is, among this corrupt generation of humanity among whom you are living, among whom ye shine and continue to shine as lights or luminaries in the world. Now the word world here is the word cosmos, which speaks of the world of humanity, the world of mankind. So you can shine as luminaries among them. We are a light in the world, and we should not take a light and put it under a bushel. We should letting our light shine and making Christ known and allowing Him to shine out through us. Allow that inner nature to be manifest on the outside. Holding forth the word of life. Now, to hold forth doesn't mean just to hold forth out there. We often say, well, in our church, boy, we hold forth the word of life. We hold forth the truth. That's not what he's talking about here. He is speaking of the individuals who go forth as witnesses for Christ as if they were one soul in their purpose. They are holding forth in order to offer. Many people will talk to others about Christ and talk about His penalty that He paid on our behalf to make us acceptable unto God. They'll do all of these things, but they never make the genuine offer to the individual to encourage them or offer them the gift of salvation if they will receive it. Now, the word is used here in secular writings as one holding forth a wine glass in order to offer it to someone. So we just not hold it forth to dangle it before them like the proverbial carrot in front of the donkey, but we hold forth in order to actually offer and give it unto them. It's a genuine offer. So we're holding forth in order to offer the word of life. The word whereby they may have life in Christ Jesus and have that eternal life. Now, Paul, why are you so eager that these believers in Philippi do this and they be so active and avid in their witness for the Savior? Here's the reason. That I may rejoice. The word I is in the emphatic position. In order that I may rejoice or boast or glory in the day of Christ. That is, in that day after the rapture and the judgment seat, and I stand before Christ at that time. And remember, we saw in chapter 1, at that period of time, there will be the full consummation, and we'll know the full fruition of all of our work and witness. Now, why would that cause Paul to rejoice in that day when he stands before Christ? Because if those believers in Philippi obey him and do what he's telling them to do here, not just what Paul is saying, but what they are instructed to do by the Spirit of God through Paul, he's writing this by direct inspiration of the Holy Spirit of God, then if they obey, then he can rejoice in it because there's going to be a lot of people there saved that would not be otherwise. Now, he says, I can rejoice in the day of Christ that I have not run in vain, neither labored in vain. Now, notice that phrase again. That I have not, or literally, that I ran not in vain, neither labored in vain. Notice here that Paul somewhat projects himself into the future as if he were already in the day of Christ. And being in the day of Christ, he says, in that day I can glory or boast because I ran not in vain on earth. I was not running in vain when I gave to you this truth that you ought to be out here witnessing and making Christ known, because there would be more people there saved that would not be had you not been faithful, and so I can boast and glory in it, and that my labor also among you was not in vain. I often say the same to people as I expand this. I trust that you will be obedient and be a witness for Christ so that my labor among you will not be in vain, but it will bring forth fruit that we can rejoice in when we stand before Christ in that day. Yea, Paul goes on to say in verse 17, yea, and if I be offered, this word offered would carry the meaning of being poured forth as a drink offering upon the sacrifice and service or the public service of your faith. Now, notice here that the faith of the Philippian believers is depicted as a sacrifice, and Paul's life being poured out is depicted as a drink offering being poured out upon the sacrifice of their faith, which is their offering. So he says, if I be poured out upon the sacrifice and service of your faith, I rejoice in that. I rejoice if I have to die for your cause there. And rejoice with you all. I rejoice with all of you as well. Notice that you all again. He's addressing this to each individual believer and not the church as an assembly. So he says, I can rejoice with all of you. Now, which means that they can rejoice, that they can give for Paul because they had it. Remember that people at Philippi were people in poverty. They were not wealthy like the ones in Thessalonica. And out of their little, they gave abundantly to Paul. And remember on one occasion, when he asked for offerings for the poor saints in Jerusalem, the church at Philippi was giving so much that Paul said, no, that's too much. You can't afford that. Did you ever hear of a preacher telling people not to give as much as they were giving? But yet Paul here was saying, I don't want you to give so much. It's too much. But because they insisted, it says they not only gave of their goods, but they gave of themselves to the Lord first and persuaded Paul to take it. Now, that is a giving of themselves, and they were willing to give themselves for Paul as they had given out of their necessities to aid him in his sickness and need while he was in this imprisonment. For the same cause, also do ye joy or rejoice. Now, ye joy and rejoice also that you could give yourself to me. And then notice the next phrase, and rejoice with me. Rejoice with is a present active imperative. Now, he says, I can rejoice that I give out to you, and in the same, you can rejoice in giving yourself for me. So he says, now rejoice with me in this matter. Now, here we see, without Paul saying it, that Paul obviously had that kind of a mind that was in Christ Jesus. He would not say so, but he's saying, pointing it out here, and the Spirit of God is making it clear that because he was willing to have his life poured out for those Philippian believers and others, that he had that kind of an attitude in him, and they were willing to give to him. Now, beginning in verse 19, we see that Paul says Timothy had that kind of a mind. Timothy had that kind of a mind in thinking in him that was in Christ Jesus, so he's given them an example of it. But I trust, I hope, I have my expectation in the Lord Jesus to send Timotheus shortly unto you. Now, he has sent this epistle unto them by the hand of Epaphroditus, who was their member that came to Rome and brought that gift which they had given. But now, he said, following this epistle as you read it, I expect that real soon now I'll be able to send Timothy to you. Why, Paul, are you sending Timothy to Philippi? That I also may be of good comfort. The word I is emphatic. He says that I may be also of good comfort when I know your state. That word state is a plural word. So he says, I can be greatly comforted when I know your state's back there, what the condition is, how you are, how you're doing. So he said, I want to send Timothy to Philippi so he can come back and report to me how you people are. Now, by saying states, he would not be happy for Timothy to come back and say, Paul, the folk at Philippi are doing fine. The church is strong. They're growing. And everything's going fine. That wasn't enough. He said, I want to know your states. How is Mary and Jane and Sue and George and Jim and Jack and everyone else? I want to know the states of the people and how things are going. But Paul, why are you sending a man like Timothy? Couldn't you just send anyone on a task like that? Why Timothy? He's too important in the ministry. Here's the reason. For I have no man, literally I have no one, like-minded, who will naturally or sincerely or genuinely or truly care for your states. Did you get what that said? I have no one like-minded here in all of Rome of these believers who will naturally and genuinely care for your states. Now, what is that saying to us? Remember in chapter 1 we saw that the majority, most of the believers in Rome, were emboldened to go out and be witnesses for Christ, and Paul rejoiced in that. But he says there's not a one who has the attitude that's in Christ and has a concern for others that they would care that much for your state to make that trip and do it. Now stop and think for a moment. Today we often hear it said, and we have people preach it and we read it in our books, that if a person is out here witnessing for Christ and endeavoring to lead others to Him in salvation, that is the very height of spiritual Christian living. That is the most spiritual person. I have to say that biblically that is really not true. A person can be a witness for Christ and lead others to Christ simply because of pride sometimes, or because they want the recognition and not because they're real spiritual minded. They are not necessarily the most spiritual people. Now, I'm not putting down people who do that. Thank God for anyone under any cause who goes out and gives the gospel and gets people saved. Remember, Paul said that he rejoiced in the fact that even those who were not sincere and did not believe the gospel were out there making it known. They had an axe to grind and a cause to champion by doing it. So he rejoiced in that. Thank God for people who will get out and witness. But some of them are just sort of neurotic about things, and they want to get recognition for it and think, I'm the greatest soul winner and what have you. But now, why is it that they are none of them like-minded? Why is it that none of them there, although they were witnesses, the majority were witnesses in that great city of Rome, that there was not a one of them that had the mind in Christ Jesus with a concern for the people at Philippi? For all, did you get that word? All seek their own. Their own is one word, and it is a plural word. They seek their own things. They're more concerned about themselves than for others. Remember what we saw in the beginning of this chapter? That I want you to have the mind that was in Christ Jesus. I want you to have an attitude of humility in which you're more concerned for others than for self. But now these, although they were witnesses for Christ, they all seek their own things, not the things which are of Jesus Christ, or not the things of Christ Jesus. They're not as much concerned about the things of Christ Jesus as they are about the things for themselves. I fear that even in our time, in our day, the majority of us are more concerned for things concerning ourselves than we are for the souls of men. Even those of us who are in the ministry and who are going out to make Christ known, we need to come to the point of having the mind in us that was in Christ Jesus, an attitude of humility in which we're concerned for others more than for self. And he says, these all, every one of them there in Rome, seek their own things, not the things of Christ Jesus. But I've had to send Timothy because no one else was willing. But ye know the proof of him. Now, you know the proof of these things concerning Timothy. How do they know that? That as a son with a father, he hath served with me in the gospel. As a son or as a child with a father, the article that is added, he hath served. He served as a bondslave or as a bondservant with me in the gospel. You were a witness of that when I was there in Philippi. Silas and Timothy were with me, and you saw it, you witnessed it, you saw what he was willing to endure and how he served as a son following his daddy around. Him, therefore, and the word him is in the emphatic position. Him, therefore, I hope or I anticipate to send presently or at once. You mean immediately after this? No, so soon as I shall see how it will go with me. In other words, as soon as I know how my trial is going to go and whether I'll be... He knew he was going to be released. He's already stated that. The Spirit of God made it known to him. But he didn't know when and how things would go in that trial and what would be. He knew the final outcome, that he was not going to be executed and he would be released so he could go to the Philippians again. That was stated already. But he said, I want to know exactly how this thing goes in this trial when I have to stand before Caesar. And at once after that is over, I'm going to dispatch Timothy to come and bring back a report to me. But, he says in verse 24, I trust, I have a settled conviction in the Lord that I also myself shall come shortly. I have the settled conviction that the Lord's going to allow me to come shortly because remember what he said earlier? And toward the end of chapter 1, that I know because it's better for you that I shall live and I can come for your furtherance and your joy in the faith. So he's saying, Timothy had that kind of a mind and that kind of an attitude. And then in the latter part of the chapter, beginning in the next verse, we find that Epaphroditus had that kind of a mind and attitude. Yet, although I'm going to send Timothy following this, and I'm going to come sometime later after that, and we do know that after Paul was released from that Roman imprisonment, he made his way to Ephesus, then he went to Philippi, then to Colossae, then as far west as Spain. Now, he said, I supposed it necessary to send unto you, to you or unto you, Epaphroditus. Now, notice here how the Spirit of God through Paul defines and describes this fellow Epaphroditus. My brother, a brother of me. He is one who is of the same womb. He is a brother in Christ to me and companion in labor or fellow laborer. I'm a laborer in the cause of Christ. He is a laborer in the cause of Christ. Paul did not consider himself to be a general and Epaphroditus to be a sergeant or something of that nature. In the Word of God, you do not find servants of the Lord being classified as some higher than the others. Each one has been given a job and a responsibility to perform before God. God is the master, and we are the servants. And whatever he assigns that servant to do, he's rewarded on the basis of how well he does his servitude and how well he does the work. For instance, a person has a great ministry that's known nationwide, and he's well known, and he sees a lot of people saved, and his name is before a lot of people. He's recognized. Another person is assigned a ministry in a small town, in a small community, and he's never known outside of the community. That does not mean that the internationally or the nationally known minister has a greater position in heaven. He's doing what God gave him to do, and he may function at 75% capacity and still make a big splash and well known, and the guy in a small local town may function at 95% capacity. His reward is greater, because he's more faithful to what God gave him to do. So he says, we are fellow laborers in the cause of Christ. He has one kind of a work to perform. I have another. So if Epaphroditus is my brother, he's a fellow laborer and fellow soldier. He is a fellow soldier as well. We are both soldiers in the cause of Christ in the army of the Lord. But he is your messenger. That word messenger is the Greek word apostolon, the word from which we get the word apostle. Now, we have the 12 apostles, but there were many others referred to as an apostle through the Scriptures. That does not mean that they were the same kind of apostle that those were of Christ. The word apostle, apostolon, simply means one who is sent on an errand with a message. Now, Epaphroditus was sent on an errand to Rome by the folk of the church at Philippi. The errand was to deliver their gift to the Apostle Paul, who was in Rome and in prison. And the message they had was that they were concerned that possibly his imprisonment had hindered the cause of Christ, as we see in chapter 1. He says, contrariwise to what you are thinking, that is not the case. So he says, he is your apostle, and is he that ministered to my wants. He publicly ministered to my wants. Now notice the word wants. It is a singular word in the Greek, not plural. And it would be better rendered need, not what I wanted, but what I needed. And he's the one who publicly ministered to my need. Paul had dire need. He was sick. Remember, he was under house arrest. He couldn't get out and work. He couldn't do anything to provide his needs of life. And so he said, I had necessities, and he provided those things and brought them to me. He's the one that publicly ministered. All of you could not do it, but he made the trip, and he did so. Now, I thought it necessary to send Epaphroditus back to you. Why? For because he longed after you all. He longed, or he was longing after you all. He really longed to be back there with you, and was full of heaviness. He was distressed. He was troubled. He was in distress and depression. Why? Because that ye had heard that he had been sick. Remember in the opening of the background information on this, I told you that when Epaphroditus had arrived in Rome, he was sick right near to death. And there was someone there, obviously, who was from Philippi, and they returned home, and they knew that word had gone back home to let the people there know that Epaphroditus was very sick and near to death. But they had not had no way of knowing whether or not Epaphroditus had recovered or whether he had died. So he was concerned about them, worried about them back home, being worried over him, and so sounds like a mother worrying about her children. But in any case, here he was concerned about the people back home, and they were concerned about him at the same time. Now, because ye had heard that he had been sick. How sick was he? For indeed he was sick nigh unto death. He was so sick, he was a next door neighbor to death. He was right on the verge of dying. But God, that makes the difference. But God had mercy on him. That's the reason he didn't die. God had mercy on him. But by having mercy on him, it was not only on him, because Paul says, and not on him only, but on me also. Now, how was it that God was having mercy upon Paul as well as upon Epaphroditus by allowing Epaphroditus to recover from the sickness and not die? Here's the reason. Lest I should have sorrow upon sorrow. Now, think of this. If someone ministered unto you and saved your life in doing so and lost their life in doing it, how would you feel about it? Now, Paul had enough sorrow, his concern for the churches and many other things. And he said, if Epaphroditus had died while ministering to my needs here to help me, then I would have had more sorrow on top of other things. So the Lord was merciful unto him as well as merciful unto me, lest I should have sorrow upon sorrow. So I sent him, therefore, the more carefully, or the more speedily, or hastily, or diligently, that when ye see him again, ye may rejoice. Ye may rejoice is one word, and it's an aorist passive imperative. Now, what does that mean? At that point in time when you see him, passive means that you will be made to rejoice because of seeing him. It's something that will come out because you see, well, he's back home, he's not dead, he made it. So when you see him again, you'll be made to rejoice, and that I may be the less sorrowful I'm less sorrowful because he's able to return back to his home. Now, how are you to feel about someone like that who is in your midst that has been willing to risk their life to do a ministry like Epaphroditus did? Here it is. Receive him, therefore, in the Lord with all gladness. Receive is a present middle imperative. Present tense means you receive him, you take him in, you continue to receive him. Don't turn him away. And middle voice says it's to your benefit that you do. Receive him, therefore, in the Lord. And imperative means it's absolutely essential to do it if you want to be right with God. Receive him, therefore, in the Lord with all gladness, and hold such in reputation or in honor, or you highly value them. You highly value anyone who has a life of service and ministry like he has had, having the mind and the attitude that was in Christ Jesus. Why do you highly value someone like that? Because for the work of Christ, he was nigh unto death. He was close to death because of the cause of Christ and for the work of Christ, not regarding his life. Now, the two words not regarding is one single word in the Greek text. It's an aorist participle, which means having hazarded his life. He hazarded his life. He put his life on the line, not regarding his own life to supply your lack of service toward me. Now, because there was a need of someone else, he put his life on the line to help them. It's like a nurse who, in a time of plague, will risk their own life to go out and minister to those people who are victims of the plague. They risk their life by doing so, knowing that it could mean that they would contract the plague and die themselves. Epaphroditus hazarded. He knew that he was risking his life by taking on this job. How is that true? We know that back in that day that bandit gangs were plentiful. They were plentiful. And these bandit gangs everywhere would kill people, rob them, take what they had. And Epaphroditus obviously had a large load to carry. Because as we see later in this epistle, Paul said, I've had enough since he's here, and now that he's gone, I have an abundance to supply me for a long time. So obviously he was carrying a large load. And no doubt because of those bandit gangs, he traveled much of the time at night undercover and hid in the daytime. And remember, they didn't have airplanes and big seagoing vessels as we have. They had sailing ships, yes. But he had to do a lot of traveling over land as well as sea in order to get there. And in his travel, he hazarded his life and he did it. And no wonder he was sick and near to death when he arrived. And he realized the dangers when he took on the job. So he was nigh unto death, having hazarded his life in order to supply your lack of service toward me. Not that no one else was willing, but all of them could not do it. Your lack of public service toward me, he did it. Now, notice, Paul is saying to these Philippian believers, brethren, I've been giving thanksgiving to God on the basis of my total remembrance of you believers back there in Philippi, and I make supplications over you with joy upon the basis of your joint participation in the gospel from the first day that Lydia was saved until the present time. And I'm convinced of this very thing, that God who has begun this good work in you of being joint participants in the gospel will consummate it or bring it to full fruition and development in the day of Christ. Now I know that you have a great love for the souls of men in the cause of Christ, and I pray that that love you have will abound more and more in knowledge and in discernment in order that you can discern things that go in different directions so that you can be sincere and without offense as you enter into the day of Christ, and that you might be filled with the fruits of righteousness which are unto God's praise and God's glory. Now, I want you to know that you're concerned that my imprisonment has hindered the ongoing of the cause of Christ, but contrariwise, my imprisonment has been a means of taking the gospel into areas it could have never gone had it not been for my imprisonment, and encouraged many others to be faithful witnesses. So you continue to be witnesses for Christ as well back in Philippi, but not in the same way that you've always done it. Now I would have you to go forth as if you were only one soul striving together with the faith of the gospel, and recognizing that it was granted to you as a privilege not only to believe into Christ, but also to suffer for His sake. And you might have to suffer the things you saw in me there in Philippi and that you hear to be in me under the authority of Rome now. Now, you've given me much joy by your obedience. But now, if you want to make my joy totally full, I want you to come to have to think just alike in this matter, that all of you have a mind of humility in which you're concerned for others more than you are for your own financial, social, material, or even physical life. Having the same mind, thinking, and attitude in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Because Jesus always had the outward manifestation, radiation of the glory of God from His person. But He was willing to give that up and come to earth and be manifest as a man, although He was God, and humbled Himself to the point of death, the lowest, most ignominious, humiliating death that anyone could die, which was a death upon a cross. Therefore, the whole Godhead highly exalted Him and favored Him with a name that is above every name, that at that name which has been given unto Jesus, every knee should bow and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Now, my highly valued brethren, you've always obeyed me in my presence, and now much more that you do it in my absence. Carry to its ultimate conclusion of your salvation. Carry to its ultimate conclusion of Christ-likeness, of having the same mind, thinking, and attitude in you that was in Christ Jesus. And do it eagerly and anxiously and no trust in yourself, because it is God who energizes in you the desire as well as the energy to work effectively of His good pleasure that you have that mind in you that was in Christ Jesus. Now, Timothy had that kind of a mind. Epaphroditus had that kind of a mind. Now, I admonish you, you have that kind of a mind and thinking in you.